So we got the depth marked on everything. It's all ready. We're gonna go ahead and do the press tool. Make sure it's on there. We're in. Just push the button.
This video is brought to you by Sporlan. Quality, integrity, and tradition.
All right, we have got an old evaporator coil. This is an R12 system that has refrigerant leaks, and it's time to replace the equipment. So we're gonna get started on that today. We have a crane coming today. The actual replacement of this evaporator in the hookup of everything will be tomorrow, but we're gonna try to do as much as we can today to make things go faster. So this is a very old system. Like I said, it's R12, existing everything. That's our line set right there, running into a chase and going towards the front of the building. We're probably going to be relocating this equipment. Trying to find my bearings right now. Looks like I have a stink pipe or a vent pipe, so I'm going to use that as my bearing because, to be honest with you, if I can, I'm just going to relocate the condensing unit right up above this. Although, I look right here and I have an AC, so maybe not. But you pay attention to this. So there's an air conditioner. I'm just kind of orientating myself. So it looks like we got an air conditioner right next to me. So it's possible. We'll look for that stink pipe. That's a direct shot straight up from about where the evaporator is. Here's my air conditioner. There's the stink pipe coming up right there, going right there. This is not really, this is the area, but this is not the ideal place for this. So we're just trying to figure this out. Got an exhaust fan right there, and the original equipment's over here, but I don't think we're gonna run the line set all the way in that stuff. We're definitely pulling the unit out of that rack, so we have to decide. Would we rather run electrical conduit from over here to this area and penetrate down? We also gotta pay attention. You don't wanna get where the water pools up. See how the water pools right there? You can see all the dirt. That's because the drain's there, so we don't wanna be in that. We also don't want to grab grease from the exhaust fan. So we got to kind of be cautious about this and make our decision as to where we're going to place this equipment. I'm thinking we might be able to place it right here. This is not a grease exhaust fan, so this one's not going to be a problem. Those ones up there are the greasy ones. So I'm thinking maybe right in this area right here. We'll have to level the unit out. Maybe put the condenser this way, facing this direction, and then the discharge air blowing out this way. We're gonna be using the main electrical feed out of here. There's fuses in here. We'll probably end up bypassing those fuses, running a direct line. Hold this up. This is a very old system. Let's see, we'll probably end up bypassing those fuses and running it hardwired and putting a fuse disconnect over here at the condensing unit. I'm thinking it's gonna be easier to pull electrical from this panel right here. We could just drill into the bottom of the box, come out, run it straight shot over here, do something over there. I think that's what we're gonna do. We're not trying to reinvent the wheel here. I'm just trying to think, I'd rather run electrical across the roof than refrigeration lines, because refrigeration lines, the insulation's gonna sit in the sun, you know, that kind of stuff. So we're gonna try to keep the line set as short as possible. So yeah, unit's gonna go right here. Electrical's gonna come down here. We'll run across all this stuff, come out here. I'm probably gonna use EMT, and we'll go get some watertight fittings. I'd like, if I can, to get this electrical ran and then have the crane show up today, set the unit, so then tomorrow we do the line set and connect the evaporator is what I'd like to do. My walk-in cooler's right here. This is an original condensing unit. To me, it doesn't look like this has ever been changed. It all looks original. We just recently converted from R12 to 409A because they had a refrigerant leak and we got a service call on it. So we had to put 409A in it. Probably should have pulled the R12 sticker, but we're the only people that work on it, so we know. We wrote 409 right there. But yeah, so we're gonna be removing this unit. We'll recover the charge and dispose of it. We're not gonna take this unit down with the crane because it's small enough that I can fit it through the roof hatch. So that way the crane's just in and out 20 minutes today is the hopes, so.
All right, we're just kind of roughing things out. We're not doing too crazy. Forgive my conduit bending. I'm not the best in the world, but I still got to do some things to level out some blocks, figure some stuff out there. Condenser unit's going right there. We're actually waiting for the crane to get here. So just kind of doing as much as I can while we're waiting.
All right, so we're climbing through the attic and we got to find a place where to put this. So, or where we can. I'm crouched down. Forgive my straining this sound. We're coming all the way over here. Right where that marker is, that piece of metal, that's the edge. And we're either going to come right, here's some busted ductwork. We're either going to come right here or on the other side of this ductwork. All this ductwork is disintegrating up here. I'm going to have to address that. But we'll either come on the other side of that or on this side. So it's either 2.5 foot from a marker or 7 foot. I'll go up on the roof and find out the best place.
All right, so I just have to make some decisions. I either go right there, you know, kind of right here, or I go right there, right in front of that condenser. So if I go here, we can discharge the air that way. I don't think it's gonna get sucked into that. We just have to make sure that the condenser's pushed back. I think we can probably, I don't know. This is interesting. I'll have to figure this one out. Right, we have determined that this is the best location right here. So we have someone holding a box downstairs to catch all the crap. When I'm drilling, I go slow, so I preserve my bit. Okay, put the box up there. Some stuff's coming down.
All right, so that is the conduit that I jacked up bending. I almost had it right and then I screwed it up. And I kind of corrected it with this one. So I went ahead and went with EMT. We used liquid tight connectors on the EMT over. We had to do offset. And then over here, it's not perfect, but I did a tiny little offset here going up into the panel. We'll secure everything down. We don't have the clamps today. Got a chase nipple in there and then got a bushing on the backside to protect it. And then we'll route the wires and zip tie them up here, get them ran up into there. We're gonna pull the wire now, and actually we need to tighten down all these electrical connectors too. I went ahead and set up a little spool thingy, and we're pulling the wire through. We got all four of them taped together, three phase with the ground. It's a short enough run that I can go ahead and push it on over there, so we're just gonna push it on down through. I don't even need a tape for this. It'd be one thing if it was a, you know, a bunch of bends and stuff, but it's so little, and it's EMT, so any kind of flexible conduit would be a little bit harder, but this is rather easy. Shouldn't be too hard. I do have fish tapes, but I honestly don't use them very often. Okay, pull about 3 feet extra, 2 feet extra. Okay, I'm gonna pull extra over here and we'll be good. All right, that's it. Okay, so we are dropping the coil down right now. We still gotta cut the refrigeration lines, but we pumped the system down on the roof. So we're gonna get this old one down and then we'll kind of figure out what we need to drill for the new coil. We still have to recover the gas, but what we did
was we just pumped all the refrigerant into the receiver so that way we can make this go faster. So it's pumped down, we took off the low side. So the guys are cutting the lines down there and they're not gonna have any refrigerant down there because the refrigerant flow has been stopped at the receiver outlet. And then we'll have someone recover the gas and remove the unit in a little while. All right, so I'm letting the nitrogen charge out of this guy and then we're just gonna do some quick checks with the depth gauge tool to make sure that there's enough room here to use the ZoomLock Max connectors, which I'm pretty sure there is. So we're gonna go ahead and do this. We gotta make sure that we ream it, deburr it, clean it, no giant scratches or anything inside of here. So gotta be very careful. I started with the pencil deburring tool. Got the big chunks out of there, okay? The biggest thing about this press kit is you can't have sharp edges inside or outside. It comes with a special deburring tool. Okay, got the line, you do the inside, and then you do the outside to get any bits out of there. Gotta make sure there's no sharp edges because it'll rip the new O-rings when it slides on. So same thing on this, I got a little bit more to do on this 3/8 right here. Comes with a depth gauge right here, get it on there, hit it with a Sharpie, mark it so that way you know how far it's going down, do the same on the 3/8. All right, we're marked. Okay, we're not going to do the press tool right now, but we're deburred, everything's good, and then we're going to hang the coil and do the press tool inside the box in a little while. I'll go ahead and cap these too, just to be safe. All right, really rough. This is how we start with the line sets. We'll clean it up here in a little while, because we're going to do a tight 90 into here. Okay, we've got the line set pushed down through. We'll deal with that after. The electrical, we're going to use that existing hole electrical right there. We're going to have to run a ground, but we're using this hole right here. So that's gonna be we're lining it up to that, and then it's not gonna match up to the old one. We'll have to re-drill new holes. We got the long drill bit. So what we do is you take tech screws and you run tech screws up temporarily, and then you put bolts in after. All right, so when we're doing the ZoomLock Max fitting, you gotta use your depth gauge. So you mark it right there. I marked it with a marker. And what you want to do is that tells you if your fitting's gonna go in there. So I reamed this, deburred it, it's nice and clean. We're gonna push the fitting on, and we have a problem. It doesn't fit right. It doesn't go to the line, it's on there crooked, and that's because I don't have enough straight pipe right here. So we can't use this. That's the importance of using the depth gauge for sure. And you also gotta make sure that you didn't damage the O-rings. You don't really wanna be putting these on and off, but it's clearly binding up, so that's not good. All right, so we are gonna go ahead and put the press tool on. Everything is where it's supposed to be. Actually, no, see, I missed one. I missed a fitting, so we're gonna fix this. I forgot to mark the depth on this one, so we're gonna fix that real quick. So we got the depth marked on everything. It's all ready. We're gonna go ahead and do the press tool. Make sure it's on there. We're in, just push the button. That one's done. Nothing's moved. Go ahead and do this one. That one's done. Gonna go ahead and do this one. Nothing's moved. Do the last one. Nothing's moved. Make sure I'm getting the jaws on right and holding them on right. I'm at a weird angle, so I'm gonna move to the other side just because I wanna make sure I don't mess this up. Guys are pressed, good to go. Okay, those guys are ZoomLock maxed on. All right, we're good to go on those. Everything's cool. Now, I haven't done this fitting because I want to slide the insulation on first. So we're gonna cap it, slide the insulation on, then we'll do that fitting last. Okay, we got two fittings on this one. We got a 7/8 and then we got a 5/8. So we're gonna do the 7/8 real quick. Okay, looks good. We're gonna pull the jaw off right here. Put the 5/8 jaw on. Good, nice and good. We're gonna do the last one. Make sure that it's on nice and tight. And it is. It's good. Okay, last fitting. Okay, we are done with this. Now we're gonna do 3/8. right? We're letting the nitrogen charge out. I'm just gonna take these valves off because they're not needed at all. Just redundant places for there to be leaks. We've got a king valve on the receiver and you have a port right here. There's no need to shut it off other than doing leak testing, but we don't need to do that, so. Okay, now we gotta bend this copper. So we left it loose in the attic, so we're gonna pull it up, bend it, then drop it back down so that way it lines right up. And you see I got the fittings cut, they're ready to go. They're cleaned, they're marked, everything's good on those. So we just need to bend this real quick, and then once we get that bend, we'll put the roof jack on, and then we'll go ahead and press them together. Actually, what we're gonna do is we're actually gonna bend it this way slightly, and then we'll twist it back. That way we can actually get the whole bend. One more. That should be good. There we go. Now we got a nice, good, solid. We'll be able to do that. And then we're gonna bend the 3/8 copper into that. Got our bends. We're gonna slide the insulation over, then we'll do our press fitting. Really important is sanding, deburring, and cleaning this pipe. It has to be perfect. No edges on the outside or the inside. So I give it a once with the pencil deburrer. Don't gotta go crazy. Just get most of it out. Then I'm gonna take the deburring tool that came with the ZoomLock Max. Again, making sure my line is pitched down. Doesn't take much. And then I'm gonna deburr the outside of the pipe. Okay, it's a little bit rough. I'm gonna take a little bit of sandpaper, sand it real quick. Let's see if I can get this up here. Sand cloth. We're making sure that we're getting it nice and clean. Okay, now there's still a little bit of a dirt or burred edge in there, so I'm gonna clean it up a little bit more. Make sure we get everything out of there. Yeah, nothing's getting in there. Okay. Cool, that's nice, that's good. No edges. Then we're gonna take the marker and we're gonna mark this guy, this out of the way, for the depth gauge. Really important to mark it so you don't screw up and not push the fitting in all the way. Okay, and then that one's ready to go. We're gonna do the same for the 3/8. And we're gonna press this guy. Press this guy. Making sure that we're getting the tool where it needs to be. Yep. Okay, that line's done. All right, we're gonna go ahead and change the jaws to a 1/2 inch. Easy as that. Go ahead and press this guy. Do one more, change the jaws one more time and do the 3/8. We had to step it down right there. Last one. Okay, we're good. Do a pressure test and a vacuum now. All right, we're gonna do this right around 150 PSI. We're gonna let it equalize out, shut off the nitrogen. And we're gonna let it calm down. It's not gonna be 404, but it's 448, but it doesn't matter right now. Okay, nitrogen shut off. Shut that off so we don't overpressurize the hoses. We're gonna go ahead and equalize the system out. Let it stabilize. open all the way, and then let it sit for about 5 minutes, and then we'll do a standing pressure test. We do that to let the pressures just equalize evenly. Okay, we have stabilized out at 157 PSI, so what we're gonna do is do a tightness test, and all that that's gonna do is time it. It's just gonna give us a timer to see how long it holds 157 PSI. So we're gonna let it run for a little while and just start cleaning up and getting the vacuum rig set up. We dropped 0.3 PSI. Now, what happened, I actually saw it happen. When my guys energized the evaporator coil, the coil temperature dropped, and the nitrogen pressure, I bet, was because of that. We've been running for 20 minutes. I don't think there's any refrigerant leaks. So we're gonna go ahead and do the evacuation now. My least favorite part is doing the roof penetration of the mastic. But as usual, I'm kind of crazy. I trace it out and put a good layer on the inside so that way it mushes the stuff out. I'm trying not to go crazy with this. So, and then I put an inner layer just to create a barrier just in case water got through. Slowly let it mush out like that. Put a couple tech screws just to hold the jack from coming up. And then we'll go ahead and seal the outside and then seal up here around this. Try not to make a huge mess. Usually this ends up everywhere and I destroy these things. All right, that one turned out pretty nice. Just use some tape. It's all good. We know that everything's nice and sealed. So we're gonna leave that be, and hopefully, my luck, we're gonna step in it, but we're gonna try not to step in it. We're just waiting for the evacuation to get done, and we're just gonna charge it up. We're using 448A when we're all done, so. We are in decay at this moment. I pulled the big vacuum hoses off, and I backseated this valve, and I hooked up the high side port just so I can pull an evacuation on my manifold and the high side port so we didn't introduce any air into the system when we go to charge it. I've pulled it down below 500 microns. We're at about 905 microns right now. It's been like that for 25 minutes. So we've passed the decay test. We're good to go. So we are getting ready to charge it up. When I charge it, I'm gonna front seat this valve all the way, put as much gas into the receiver, and then open it and control the flow with that valve right there. We are running. So now we gotta charge it. We're still low on gas, so. We're gonna add the normal charge, and then we'll calculate the flooded charge after that. So we're gonna clear up the sight glass first. I went ahead and the bypass pressure is like 140 PSI on that. I think it's 148. Yeah, 148, it's a funky valve. So I disconnected one condenser fan motor and I'm clearing the sight glass above the bypass pressure. We're at 170 right now. So I clear the sight glass. Once I get a clear sight glass, then Russell has already calculated how much extra refrigerant to add to properly flood the condenser. So that's how we're gonna charge this one. This is one of those times we're leaning on the manufacturer, they give me the data. It took 9 pounds of refrigerant to clear the sight glass, but that's not including the winter charge. Then I wrote the winter charge below that of 3.8 pounds. So this has a total system charge of 12.8 pounds. I have not added the winter charge yet, we're gonna add it right now. So we just turned on, and we're gonna go ahead and add it till we get to 3.8 pounds, then we're fully charged to flood the condenser properly. All right, with the proper flooded charge given to me by Russell, I went ahead and when I was done, heated up the receiver and found my liquid level to be right here. You can clearly see the liquid level and I can clearly feel the heat temperature. So I'm gonna go ahead and mark it. It's at the 3/4 mark actually, but I'm gonna go ahead and mark it for the next guy so that way it makes it easier. All right, our equipment is running. Went ahead and labeled it in a few different places right there in the electrical panel. Marked the liquid level on the receiver for the next guy. And then also you guys already saw, but right up top on the condensed unit up there is all the data. So we're just putting the unit back together. We're gonna let it go. I'm going to probably come back in a day or so after the system operates just to make sure everything's working properly, and then we'll do the superheat check and all that. Unit's looking good. We'll put a Ketotherm 10 Plus defrost controller. The Russell condensing unit came with a defrost clock on the roof, but we eliminated it, went to the Ketotherm. That way the customer can see when it's in defrost. Box is down to temp, everything's good. Like I said, I'm gonna give it a day or two, come back, do a follow-up, check superheat, all that good stuff, so.
All right, that was an interesting one. That was a first for me using the ZoomLock Max. I have to say it was a rather easy process, but there's some details you have to follow, okay? You really, really have to prep the pipe correctly, inspect the pipe, deburr it, make sure that everything is correct. You do not want any burrs to rip the O-rings. That's what's gonna make the ZoomLock Max work correctly, okay? If you're not following through with your prep, then you're gonna have problems, okay? Everything was good on this one. Real quick before I forget,
and we'll talk more about it. The beanies are now available, guys. I have non-cuffed and cuffed beanies available on the website. Okay, they are active right now. Feel free to check them out, okay? So with the Zoom Lock Max, yeah, it's really in the details. You got to make sure that you're prepping everything correctly, okay? Now, I'm not going to use Zoom Lock Max on everything, guys, okay? Yes, I'm still going to braze, okay? Obviously, you know, we got to change an expansion valve, solenoid valve, you still have to braze. But there's times when the Zoom Lock Max is convenient, appropriate for certain situations, and it's another tool in our arsenal of things to use, okay? Certainly if I'm doing a lot of refrigeration fittings, you know, yeah, I might use the Zoom Lock Max again. Okay. It really depends. Where this would be very beneficial is in situations where you have to pull fire permits, where you have to do fire watch, that kind of stuff. Okay. And if you don't know what that is, sometimes there's certain locations because of, for whatever reason, you're not allowed to have open flames. You're not allowed to braise without going through all kinds of crazy hoops and all kinds of things. Okay. So this would be perfect in that situation, depending on what you're working on. Okay. Again, obviously you're still going to need to braze in a compressor. Okay. But this is a cool option to have in your toolbox. Okay. Really awesome. So as far as the installation goes, nothing too crazy. Okay. You know, we're retrofitting an existing walk-in cooler, so it's not perfect, right? Nothing about my stuff is ever perfect. And I try to make that shown as much as possible. Okay. I'm not the most amazing person with an electrical conduit bender. It, you know, there's lots of things I could probably rip it apart more than you guys could rip it apart. Okay. There's a lot of stuff that I really wish I would have done better. I wish I would have given myself more room when it dropped out of the electrical panel and I 90'd it. But unfortunately, I made that slight transition, so I couldn't, but I would have loved to have put some sort of a vibration absorber underneath it. You know, just that kind of stuff. All right. We're all human, right? We do our best with what we have, but we also have restrictions from the customer. This customer doesn't want this to cost $10 million, you know? So I'm giving them the best that I can with what their budget allows, and we're trying to do the best job possible, okay? So on this system, we ended up going to R448A, okay? For those that don't know, get ready. You'll start seeing it soon, okay? In refrigeration, the state of California, it's not just California, but California adopted some rules that were previously thrown out by the government. But anyways, that's a bunch of politics. But California, we have a rule that we're not allowed to use R404A on new installations, on retrofits, or anything like that. Okay, so we have to go to alternative refrigerants. So I have chosen to use R448A. It's done me really well in medium and low temperatures. I do not do any supermarket work, so my changeouts and stuff are relatively easy. I choose to make it as easy as possible, so I usually change the entire system when I'm doing a conversion. But you know, there's things that you can do. You can retrofit existing systems, but you got to change the nozzle and the you know, distributor and different things like that. Okay, but this was a relatively easy change out. If you guys you really didn't see the pressures operate very much, but on this system the pressures are very similar to what R22 was on medium temperatures. You definitely run much lower pressures on the high side in the summertime and stuff like that, but your evaporator temperature and your condensing temperature is still the same. The fundamentals are still the same, okay? Keep in mind, I do live streams on Monday evenings, 5 p.m. Pacific, work permitting. So long as I can get off work in time, I'll do a live stream, and I'm sure there's going to be lots of questions from this video. I'll be answering those there, okay? Also, on Friday evenings, about 6.05 p.m. Pacific time, I go live on the HVAC Overtime YouTube channel with my buddies, HVACR North Joe, A-Team Adam and Curious HVAC Guy Bill, and we all just kind of talk about the week. So I'm sure we're going to be talking about this this video and using the Zoom Lock Max tool. Hey, some people don't want to use the press tools, and that's fine. It's okay. It, like I said, it's just another tool in the arsenal to use whenever you see fit. Okay, I really, really appreciate you guys. Okay. Please consider subscribing if you haven't already. Leave me some feedback. Leave me a comment, thumbs up, thumbs down, whatever you think. I'd really, really appreciate it, okay? Other than that, we will catch you guys on the next one.